Okay. Good evening, everybody. Welcome all of you to our next interesting monthly seminar of PMCP. I have extreme pleasure in welcoming all of you to this webinar. And it is indeed always a pleasure to welcome my friend, introduce my friend Vivek Prakash, today's speaker. And I'm sure all of you know of him. But just to give you a glimpse of his career, he has been into the IT industry and project management for more than 30 years today. And he has worked across multiple multinational companies before starting his own organization, pmwares. He has been running that pretty successfully. More, this is a great example of, you know, how passion can drive business. He is equally passionate about project management and the best practices, which he not only teaches, but he also practices. So today is going to be an interesting topic about Agile in PMP. And I'm sure all of you will benefit from it. Look forward to the session. And basic hygiene things, as mentioned earlier, please send your queries or anything on chat. I will be monitoring it and will help you get all your responses as soon as possible during the session. Over to you, Vivek.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for giving me undue credit, and so which you always do. And let's get started with the things you already have that behind you. That was a little new. The background is yours. Is this only actually? So that was very interesting actually today.
Yeah, I'm learning to be current with technology.
that's a good idea actually. I never thought of this.
Yeah.
Good. Okay. Thank you very much, Kalyan. And let's get onto this. Today, I will be focusing more on like Agile and PMP exam. And because PMP exam has got some makeover or changeover kind of things from 2001. And many people normally takes a couple of months, or many times they give exam after years or so. So as a preparation of the PMP exam, some time back, we were not covering Agile as was not part of it. But now it is like almost 50% of the questions are having influence of Agile. 25% or maybe 30% are almost on Agile. And another 20-25% are having influence from Agile. That is called hybrid kind of model. And many people look for like, what is this? And especially the people who are not part of the IT industry. So the Agile is not that much heard outside of IT industry. Even in the IT industry, it's quite wide. It's quite popular, despite many people, maybe especially very senior, may not be getting into or knowing very nitty-gritties of Agile. Now, Agile is in itself is a full development or full methodology and a full, I would say, a subject in itself. But do we need to understand everything in Agile to attempt PMP exam? That is maybe the question which will be bubbling in the mind of many people. And if it is not full, then how much and what I need to study in Agile so that I'm well prepared for PMP exam. This is what the core theme of today's program. So I will cover up some concepts here, and I will also definitely will put those concepts in perspective with the PMP exam. So I will bring those questions here. So let's get into, and I will start with the question itself, and I will ask people to attempt it. So my first thing is the first question, which is in front of you, and you need not to answer in the chat box. I will launch a poll and you answer in the poll actually. Where is the poll? Yeah. Right. So I will launch a poll. You can read the question until then, and the options is. So the poll is there, and the time given is not more than 1 minute. Okay, every question, I have a couple of questions, and I will not give you more than 1 minute. So that's what is expected also in the exam. And you need not to think too much about it. Just whatever on the top of your head, just answer that. So 10 seconds left. In 10 seconds, I will close this.
Okay.
Okay. So maximum answers. I'm not sure. Are you able to see the results? Kalyan, you are able to see or anybody?
Yeah. No.
Yes.
Achha. We can see, probably all of them may not be able to see them.
Okay.
Let's read out.
So the okay, I think these are the answers. Now people can see that, I think. People can see that now?
Yeah, now they should be able to.
Yes.
Okay. Yes, so sir. Maximum answers have gone to A and the C. So let's look at this. What is the answer for this? So C is the answer for this, and a lot of people have answered correctly as such. Not a problem. We are not here checking your all knowledge. We're just trying to put things in context. And we say that what kind of terminology is coming, and you get familiar, or either you familiar or you may get familiar with that. Maybe let's attempt another question. And for that, I will launch the second poll. This time you have to answer two answers are there. So tick any two. You have 60 seconds. So 10 seconds are left. Okay, so I'm ending the poll now. Okay, and see those results. So maximum answers have gone to A and E. A and E. And let's look at the right answer as such. So I will stop sharing this results, and answers are B and D. Okay. So now you may be, this questions are especially kept at this point to see that, like, what kind of understanding of Agile is required, what kind of the words are being used, what are the kind of jargons are being of the Agiles are being used. And are we familiar with this? Many people may be familiar, many people may not be familiar, and may be confused which one to choose as such, right? So now let's look at this. Whenever you have any questions, please put this into the chat box. And the Kalyan and Keetan will be watching that, and they will capture the questions, and we will have those question answers later. Okay, let's look into this program. Okay, from where this Agile come, what is the context, and what Agile pod means as such. So there are three types in executing the projects. There are three types of life cycles. One is predictive, another is adaptive, and third is hybrid, the mix of predictive and adaptive. Okay. Now, what is predictive? Predictive is a plan-driven also, and PMI says it is also plan-driven or simply a waterfall model, right? It flows from one side to other side. There is no provision of going back and reviewing the things. There is a provision, but generally it is not expected. The changes are generally not considered, or if considered, there is a process of change request. Maybe you can say a little heavy process. Okay, so you can go back with a change request and may do the modifications, but they are not encouraged in general. Generally, we understand that you please gather and confirm and freeze the scope and requirements in the beginning. The hybrid type is second, the adaptive and the predictive. So adaptive is normally iterative in nature. Adaptive is normally iterative in nature. So you see the iteration one, iteration two, one, two, three, four, and there is an iteration. So what this hybrid is saying is a mix of iterative and waterfall. So something is going in sequence and something is being delivered in iterations. So like you gather all the requirements, you develop the whole architecture, but design, development, right, design, coding, unit testing, integration testing are doing in a small part. So part by part, you are developing, maybe incrementally, maybe refining things. And then at the end, you are doing system testing and acceptance testing and delivering it. You will see many terminology will come from software because Agile has originated from software. Still, it is by and large confined in software, though other industries are also adopting it. Now, third is adaptive. Now, adaptive has three flavors, the iterative, incremental, and Agile. Now, iterative is something like you can say it is like continuously refining things. You prepare something and then refine it and further refine it. So what is happening? That scope is not changing, scope is not increasing, but the product is improving. Scope is not increasing, but product is improving. Product is getting better and better. Now, in the incremental, the product will not be getting better, but it is getting more features and more features. So scope is increasing. So product get more and more features. While in iterative, the product doesn't get more features, but get better. Performance get better. Whatever is provided now function much better than earlier. In incremental, the product is getting new features, new things getting added. The product is actually swelling, is getting bigger and bigger and mature. So I will say, if you want to use term mature, use it for iterative. If you can talk about the product is getting bigger and bigger or getting more functionality, then you think about incremental. Now, Agile is an approach of iterative and incremental. Agile is an approach to iterative and incremental. Both are together. And generally the projects are like that. You will find very few projects which are may not find projects which are completely iterative or completely incremental. The projects are generally iterative and incremental. You refine the things which are already there because you have got some feedback, plus also add some features into that. Most of the product go this way. Now, what is we are doing in Agile? In the hybrid, you see something we put this into, something we have some sequential, then iterative, and then sequential, and then maybe other mixture are also allowed. But here, everything is getting into completely iterative. So you get some requirement, you plan it out, you design it, you develop it, you test it, you integrate it, you test it, you deliver it. Then you take another requirement, you plan it, you design it, you develop it, you test it, you do an acceptance testing with the user and deliver and get the feedback. And the whole cycle is going into sequence and especially in Agile, short iterations, somewhat between 1 week to 4 weeks. A 2 week iteration is very common. It encourages your continuous integrations. The whatever you're developing, the product you are developing is always functional, though maybe at the lower level or maybe with the less functionality, but it is functional. You can use it. And that is the primary aim of Agile, that whatever requirements you have, you develop it and deliver a working product. So user can use it and provide you feedback. Based on feedback, you can add features or you can refine older features which are already provided. This way, the product get mature and mature and mature, get better and better over time. The customer satisfaction is very high at the end because of it. Quite possible that the things may take a little more time because it is getting better than earlier. Now, where these things are normally used, Agile is very suitable for software projects. First of all, the changing requirement is easier. Repairing is easier. Refining is easier. Right? So there is less cost involved. There is a cost involved, but that may not be that much. Predictive and plan-driven are normally in the construction projects, in the big product development project, which have some physical things, and repairing or modifying them is not so easy. Like you're constructing building, if you want to modify, that's going to be very difficult actually. Right? So the construction project normally go in a plan-driven approach. But let me tell you, we have clients who are even trying to put agile concepts in construction. And some, by and large, I say that construction also use iterative approach, though very large scale, but the projects are also very large, right? A crore rupees project in agile in software may be quite big, but a crore rupees project in construction probably may not be much bigger. Actually, it may be a small project.
So Vivek, there is a question here. Sorry to interrupt.
Yeah.
Somebody wants to know, architecture also should be in the predictive lifecycle model.
In agile, if you are using agile, then probably architecture also get refined. So there's no such kind of, like, you can have some kind of bigger architecture which in the iteration zero, which normally called iteration zero, but this is also subject to refine. This is all subject to refine.
I hope the person who raised the question have got the respective message.
Yeah, at the end, we will again look into this if he is okay. Not so satisfied with that.
Okay.
Now, look at the iterative, as I said, it is refinement continuously, no new feature getting added, but refinement. So if you see, we are talking about this, but there is no real application of only iterative or only incremental. So normally it is increment and iterative, and hybrids are used in many places, especially those places which were earlier using the plan-driven approach, but now adopting Agile. So they are in a transition stage. They have not adopted Agile completely. They have not. They are not also not completely plan driven and mostly using hybrid approach. And different companies have a different combination of these two things. So it's very difficult to tell, okay, only this way it is hybrid. Maybe any kind of mixture of Agile and plan driven is, we call it hybrid. And there are many projects in construction industry. If you see in the manufacturing industry, there are many examples. In fact, a lot of lean is already being used in manufacturing far before than agile concept. And because agile has adopted all lean principle into agile, so you can say there is an agility already there in the manufacturing sector. So we can talk about those concepts as such, but those are more organic than inorganic. Now let's look at another question. Read this question and I will launch the third. Meanwhile, I launch the third poll. Let's see if we understood anything of this. So here is the option for you to select. You have 60 seconds. So last 10 seconds. Okay. So large majority is in favor of B, that is the agile approach. Probably that may be the right answer, I think. Right, so that is the right answer also. So very good, I think we're going very, very well on this. So at least we get some understanding, and probably this is a basic understanding, maybe many of you already have it. Now, let's look into the Agile now. So you have got that where the Agile come from and what is the context of Agile. So it has started somewhat in 2001. It was at a very basic level. And when it is getting matured in, I think it takes a couple of years to mature, or some people hear about it. And there are so many different practices in Agile. It took some little time for coherence actually to come together and form one method. It's still, there are a couple of practices there in Agile, different methodology. But what this manifesto which these people have prepared, what it says, there are four things which are important. This says that process and tools are good, but individual and interactions are more important for us. This is something like philosophical level, and absolutely there's a conceptual level and a philosophical level. We more believe into working software than comprehensive document. Okay, then instead of doing some contract negotiations, we will more talk about customer collaboration. And instead of following a plan, we will respond to the change. Yeah, there are some plus and minuses, but they ultimately zero down on these four basic, philosophies or which actually the base of the manifesto. And this is how the whole Agile is driven from this. So what Agile become actually? So it is an incremental and evolutionary software development approach in a highly collaborative environment by a self-organizing team. So this is expected that the people who are part of the Agile, they don't need really a manager who actually guide them, manage them, or ask them to do something. They should be doing their job their own. Now, it's an ambitious goal looking at today's market look for talent. Getting a talent itself is very difficult, and getting a talent which is self-organized is probably be a little more difficult even today. But that's what we look for. With just enough attitude, delivering high quality software, which is time to market advantage in short time boxed iterations, meeting the changing stakeholders need. So the main things are highlighted. It is incremental and evolutionary, that is, I would say iterative. And then it should be, it is a collaborative environment, more collaboration with self-organizing teams. The things will be delivered in short time box, means fixed time. Time box means a fixed time of iterations, and will respond to changing stakeholders' requirements. That is another primary goal of this, that the thing changes. And actually the software, a lot of changes were actually coming. Other places it may not be, because the things are tangible in software, because the non-tangible nature of the software, actually intangible nature of software, actually make it little difficult to explain the requirement, and therefore a lot of changes were agreed, and there it was a requirement that we should respond to it. So what are the basic principles from this manifesto actually? So these principles that satisfy the customer through early and continuous delivery. Welcome changing requirements. So don't resist. There were a lot of resistance with the changes. I have myself have seen when the customer comes to the changes. No, this is a change. By the way, let me tell you, I am also talking with a lot of agile team, and they also resist the change so many times. But fair enough, the habit is habit. Probably in some time, we may not see those kind of resistance actually, or in a scope or out of the scope kind of things as such. Deliver working software frequently. So deliver working software and frequently, means in short time. Again and again, adding one in, instead of adding 10 features and then delivering, add one or two features and deliver it. Work together, daily interaction. In fact, it is like last one, if you see, it is also talking about face-to-face interaction, come togetherness together. So last 1.5 year, or almost like 2 year now, I'm getting 1.5 year at least for sure, the face-to-face conversation has really a challenge actually. But people have find their tools in these circumstances also in the virtual environment. Build project around motivated individuals. That may be a challenge. And I feel when I go and talk with the teams and see that, yes, it is still a challenge. Working software is the primary measure. Whenever you deliver, it should be working. Sustainable development, maintain a constant pace. Try to maintain a constant pace, like every time deliver a fixed amount of work, a fixed amount of work on a regular basis, right? Continuous attention to the technical excellence. Practically, simplicity, observe simplicity. Self-organized team, we already discussed, and reflection. Look for the feedback. This is another aspect of this. Look for the feedback. Early delivery means let the user uses it and provide the feedback. These are the core principles behind all the work being done. Now, how much agile team are implementing them depending upon their maturity of understanding these principles. Many teams are doing fantastically. Many teams are also doing horribly. They just tell agile and they hardly mean actually as such. What is time boxing? Time boxing means there is a fixed time frame. You have to deliver in this time frame. So suppose you decided to that I have 2 weeks of iteration. That means you will take only that much of work which can be completed in two weeks. Now, suppose you couldn't complete the things in 2 weeks. Fair enough, whatever is not completed will not be delivered, but after 2 weeks, we will deliver whatever is completed. Okay, so, but after 2 weeks, it is something is done, that is done, which is not done is going back to the backlog, going back into the requirement backlog, right? So, but in 2 weeks, we will deliver something. So, and now 2 weeks is fixed, then whole time is just 2 weeks only. If you have fixed 3 weeks, then every time it is 3 weeks only. No change in the iteration duration as such. We cannot have this iteration 2 weeks, next iteration 3 weeks, next iteration 1 week, and next iteration 4 weeks. No, it's not. It's always fixed duration. When is agile suitable? Agile is suitable when there is some kind of uncertainty. Now, this uncertainty may be pertaining to requirement or pertaining to the technical knowledge. So the best way to implement the Agile is either this quadrant or this quadrant. This quadrant is very simple because there is no changing. Probably you can apply the plan-driven approach also in the first in this quadrant. Or this quadrant is too much uncertain. Probably even adopting Agile, maybe challenges will be too many with you. So see that in which quadrant you fall before you really apply the Agile and see your challenges in the project. There are some advantages. Indeed, handling requirement volatility, you change the requirement, I'm ready to handle it. Okay, early to the market, better quality because you can continuously refining, early market because you can deliver a small and give it and market can go to the market. High visibility, better risk management, right product, because you are continuously getting feedback from the customer, right? And high customer satisfaction because customer get what he's talking about or what he wants really. Even if customer is not very clear what he wants, he can shape up the product over time and can get what he really or what can satisfy him actually. So this way it is quite satisfying as such. But there are challenges with Agile. It is highly engaging. Many customers may not like this. They say, oh no, I don't have time for your engaging yourself, myself in the daily meeting yours. Or you give me, I have given you something like that. Scope creep. Unnecessary requirement can also seep into the project because we are little less bother about validating the requirement. It's a good approach that we validate the requirement, whether it is required or not. But the way we have structured this, probably there is a possibility, easily possible that a unnecessary requirement can come into and later we find it is not required and we need to reject it. And the efforts go waste. Higher cost because you are continuously refining and the requirements are changing and we are not thinking complete product in the beginning. So later more we think, more the expansion happen, maybe deliver late and at a higher cost. But the advantage is that you will get what you want. A lot of people dependence. This is a self-organizing team we are talking about. A lot of people dependency. A couple of years ago, the principle was that we should reduce people dependency. And now all of a sudden, a new approach has come, which is people dependent. Now, many senior managers are still not able to digest this. Okay, whether we make it people dependent or people independent. So those dilemmas are always there. Low clarity on the shape of the final product. In fact, that may not be called a challenge, but that is where the Agile come into picture. You can say that. Now, what is Agile lifecycle? Agile lifecycle goes around these four phases, or you can say four places, like you have exploration, plan it out, iteration it and reduce it. These are the four major part of Agile. So what are you doing in exploration? Exploration, you are gathering requirement and writing stories. What is story? A story is a requirement in the words of user itself, like user's language. We use user's language. User should understand what the requirement, not in technical term, but in a business term. So writing stories, that is the requirement, what the user want, and collecting requirement as much as possible. Okay, these parts are not like sequence, they are iterative, right? Every time we do this, if we are doing a continuous basis. So these four things are happening on a continuous basis. It's not like going from left to right. Then we prioritize these. We do a planning. So prioritize the stories based on the preferences of user. And we estimate the stories in story points many times. And we decide the time to market. Right? So such kind of planning we do. Plus we also decide what is to be taken in the iteration. Maybe we can see later. Then we start our development. So we when we do a development, we do a stand-up meeting every day so that we can sync up and we know how to refine the how to address the issues which we are encountering, often called impediments, and keep tracking them and keep resolving them so that we can deliver at the end of iteration whatever we want to deliver or whatever we have taken up. Then at end of the iteration, it is review, which is done with the product owner or the stakeholders, customers who see the review and demonstration and can give the feedback. And we also do a retrospective, which is basically talks about in the last iterations, what went well and what didn't go well. Right? Looking back and seeing that what better we can do in next iteration. So that we iteration over iteration, we can improve. And then the release. So in a couple of iterations, you can have a release as such. And you can have user recommendation, documentation, you can have user testing, you can have user training, and deliver a basic functionality product. And then you can keep refining and keep adding things into that. These are the basic, very high level life cycle of Agile. Let's look into little deeper in this. Let's get into little deeper and we will use some methodology to understand that what is how these things are really happening inside Agile. Now, when we're talking about Agile, as I said earlier, there were various methods were in practices when these people come together and prepare an Agile manifesto. Now, many of these things, many of these practices are now died, gone very, having very, very few people using it. But one thing which has been almost come out as a most popular approach is the Scrum. So today's Agile, by and large, roam around Scrum. And XP is also in the practice, but very few people use it. Feature driven also in picture, but it is very few people use it, right? So these things are being used, but now the popularity has decreased, but Scrum's popularity has increased significantly, and things are going by and large as per the Scrum. Now, let's look into more detail in what is happening in Agile. So there are three basic things. One is people, what role they are playing, what activities are they are doing called ceremonies, and what documents or product or artifacts we are using called artifacts. Now, we will look into Agile frameworks. And what I am going to use here is the Scrum framework. So through Scrum framework, we will understand the Agile framework. So I will give you terminology of Agile, Scrum as well as the generic terminology, which is used in Agile. Many times we don't have a generic terminology. We just use Agile terminology. And despite PMI tells that, and PMI's intention is that don't follow one method or do not recommend any one method. But I have seen by and large when the questions are framed and the questions are being there, they move around or roam around or use around the Scrum only. Now, this is something that overall framework of Agile. Look at this. There is a product owner and he provide requirements. So there is a backlog, which is a stack of requirements. Then there is a sprint planning in which we take some requirements from the product backlog and put into sprint backlog. Then we do an iteration and we do the execution. We go into development, and during development, this we meet daily, discuss impediments and what happened yesterday, what is going to happen today, what is any problem or not, and so that our flow should not be blocked or stopped or slowed down, and we should deliver what we have taken up. And once the iteration is over, iteration time box is over, then whatever you have developed, you actually present it to stakeholders. Maybe product owner is one of them, or maybe other stakeholder, user may also be there. So present it, demonstrate it, basically whatever you have developed, and give it to and let them give you feedback. Something may be accepted, something may not be accepted. Whatever is accepted, it is done. You can integrate it with the product. Whatever is not accepted can go back and put into the product backlog and for again to be taken up in the next iteration, or maybe depending upon the priority. There is a sprint retrospection also. As I said, we will do after every sprint, we will do retrospection, what went well, what didn't go well, and what better we can do in next iteration, right? And this is all done by the Scrum team. So there are roles, there are ceremonies, there are artifacts. Let's look into them a little more in details. So first we look into the roles. And roles are the product owner who owns the requirements, who give the requirements, who help prioritize the requirements. He basically represent the user in the team. User in the team, you can say. Like, he may be, maybe sometimes he may be funder also, and accept or reject the sprint result. This may be in consultation with the user. Then second is the team, right? Scrum Master normally can be called team facilitator. Okay, so the project manager's role is a kind of undefined in Agile, or it is not defined, or people advocate that project manager is not required. But we need a facilitator, which in Scrum is called Scrum Master, who is a facilitator. What he does, help the team to be successful, that whatever he looks for, the impediments, issues, what problems team are facing, what kind of things are required, and try to facilitate things to the team so that team can deliver with full productivity. He can help it out with the team to define the structure, remove impediments, like see that how we can achieve the best performance out of it, how the productivity of the team can be improved, right? Shield the team from external interference, does not allow the external interference to disturb the team. So team can concentratedly work on the things which they have selected to deliver in the situation. That is the Scrum Master or facilitator's job, basically. The third is team itself. Team is generally a cross-functional team. In Scrum team or the Agile teams are generally cross-functional teams. So all kinds of resources should be there. In fact, we will learn about it. Skills are or talent are more recommended, which is like people have strength in one area but have a good understanding or knowledge and can work on other areas as well. So they are not just specialist. Sometimes a word is used, generalized specialist. So they are generalist as well as a specialist in one area. So they know a lot. And sometimes in a very technical term, it is also called a full stack developer. The agile knows everything actually. So if the expert person is not there, the Y person can do the X person's job, something like that. It is dedicated for the team full time. And if a member has to change, it will change between two iterations. But because iterations are generally of 2 weeks, so it's not such a big deal as such. The second is the ceremonies. Second is ceremonies. Ceremonies means activities within the Agile framework. The first is planning. So first is release, project planning or release planning. In the project, we actually plan release. Release are generally having some features to be delivered, and those features are delivered or developed through several sprints. And each sprint may have some kind of features to be delivered. And during this time, we do daily scrum. This is how the overall project normally planned. So when we have planned first release, probably we may not having a very great idea about the release too. And that's how the Agile works. So we are not thinking too much about the release two. Let's concentrate on release one, right? So let's plan the release one, and then we will, once the release one is getting matured, then we'll talk about the release two. So we do not think too much of long-term in that case. Total long-term means at a high, very high level. Detail level, we don't plan the releases of futures. Then there is a backlog preparation and refinement. So what is a backlog? Backlog is a stack of requirements. And the idea is that refine it based on the business preferences, the user's preferences, stakeholder preferences. Refine the backlog. Many times stories are quite big. So you break down into smaller pieces. Or some are already well-defined, but they have to be ordered correctly. So this is a continuous process throughout the project. We continuously, as the people, as the stakeholders' preferences are changing, as we get new requirements, as we get new changes in the requirements, we keep refining this backlog, which is a continuous process throughout the project. Then we do iteration planning. In a Scrum, we call it sprint planning. Now, what is iteration planning? Normally, the product owner, Scrum Master, that is the facilitator, and the teams are normally part of it. And what they do, they prioritize the backlog and select some of the items for the sprint. So create a sprint backlog. Look into the design part, high-level design, see that it is okay or not. Right, generally should be of 2 hours max, maybe 3 hours, 4 hours. I don't think it would run more than 4 hours. Then there is a daily stand-up meeting which happens every day. It's saying daily stand-up in daily, it's called daily scrum in the Scrum framework. Who attend this? My team, the Scrum Master, product owner, maybe customer also, maybe other user also, right? What is the agenda? What did I do yesterday? What will I do today? And are there impediments? So that the Scrum Master or the facilitator can take those things and work to remove them, right? Daily stand-up meeting we call, so that we call it daily stand-up because people physically do not sit. They remain standing. Why? Because we do not want it to be more than 15 minutes. So for 15 minutes, why to sit down? If you sit down, probably you may take more time, but it is not, you are not sitting down. So fair enough. Okay. Then once the iteration is complete, things are developed, then they are demonstrated for review to the stakeholders, maybe product owner, maybe users, and other stakeholders also. You can invite the customer, etc. No PPT, only demonstration, okay? Only demonstration. And in this, the customer or user or the product owner provide feedback. They may accept or reject the outcome. And whatever is accepted is done, which is rejected can be put into the backlog again. Then there is a retrospective. After the review, then the review, the retrospective happen after the review or demonstration. Now here we try to learn what should we start doing. That is, we didn't do in last iteration, but we should do in next iteration. What should we stop doing? What we did in last iteration, but we shouldn't be doing that in the next iteration because it's not a good practice. It is creating problem for us. What should we continue doing it? That means what we did in the last iteration, it's a good practice and we should continue in the next iteration as well, or maybe future iterations as well, right? That is the whole objective of the retrospective. And you can have multiple things, but you can select one or two to implement in the next iteration. This way you can also encourage continuous improvement. In every retrospective, not necessarily you will get some learning point or some changes, but in some retrospective, you can get many actually. This happens in the beginning, you get many, in the later iterations, you may get less. And at the end, last iterations, maybe few, maybe you get another time more that what we have not done good. So many things are there. Then we talk about artifacts. What are the artifacts? Product backlog, as we have understood, it is a collection of requirements and it is continuously required reprioritization, which often called grooming product or the product backlog grooming. Okay, which is basically a reprioritization. These all story which are there in the backlog should be estimated in story points. Will come to this little later. For example, as written here, as a seller, I should be able to add a product on portal to sale, right? So it is, we are writing in like the user himself is writing. So that is called a story. So user can easily understand, yes, this is what I want, or this is what I don't want, or he can make some refinement into this. Then there is an iteration backlog. We can call sprint backlog. So what is iteration backlog? We are in the sprint planning or iteration planning before the iteration. And we are selecting some of the items from the product backlog to put into sprint backlog or iteration backlog, we call it. And using for, and these are the things which we develop in the iteration. We should pick up only that much of work which we can deliver in the time box iteration, whatever it is, 1 week, 2 week, 3 week, or 4 week, whatever it is. Right? And we can reprioritize this. We can assign the things to members, team members, who will do what kind of things. But it is all done by team itself. It is not done by Scrum Master or Facilitator. The last thing is the measurement. The measurement, the burn down chart is very common, which talks about that in the beginning, we were having so many stories, X number of stories. Now we are left with the, let the 100 story was there. After first iteration, we are left with the 95 stories. After second iteration, we have got to 97 stories. How 97 stories? Maybe we completed 5 stories, but 6 may get added. We completed 4 stories, 7 may get added. So 2 more, right? So because it is continuously adding and we are developing, so it may go up and down both the sides actually. But our aim is that we can continuously reduce them on a regular basis, get a velocity. So something like that. If you look at this, a straight line going, this is our ideal velocity actually, that at this level, at this rate, we should deliver the stories. But we may not exactly follow that. So sometimes more, sometimes less, sometimes more, sometimes less, sometimes more, sometimes less. Besides burn down chart, we also use burn up chart. So it's just opposite to that. How much stories are done? Here, how many stories are left? Burn down chart. And here we are checking how many stories are done so far, which is a conventional method also. But we many times, we also use the burn up chart. There are other measurements also, but I think in this, we can just focus on this. So let's look into one more question. Let's see if you can attempt this. Maybe it is somewhat related to this. You read this. This is the poll. So I've launched the poll and you have 60 seconds. You have to select two, okay? Okay, next few minutes. Attempted, maybe I'm going to close the poll. Okay. So see that, I think the answers are quite confusing in that sense, though the C has got more votes as such. But others are almost on the equal side as such. But let's look at the answer as such. So answer are B and C. So people have predicted C quite well as such, but probably people think that customer engagement in the daily stand-up meeting may not be, it may be too much. But this is what the difference of what Agile may be looking forward, and we may not be thinking like that, something like that. So let's move ahead from this phase and get into that. Besides Scrum, there are other methods also, like Kanban. It's normally called more visual. It's normally called a demand-based method, where we can see everything on the board and how many stories in the backlog, how many in progress. And these Kanban boards are quite popular during the iteration development, during the iterations. So that is one of the methods is used, and maybe mix up with the Scrum method, and both together are going as such. So Kanban methods, Kanban or especially electronic Kanban in last 1.5 years are very, very popular now. Some tools are based on this only. In fact, if you see an Agile tool, the Kanban will be there. So Kanban board will be there. So it becomes a very popular one. So it's a flow-based thing. It's easily visible. You can see what is the status of things. Main item is you can limit the in-progress items. You can limit the in-progress item, and it's quite visible to everyone that where we stand. You need not to share the status every project. You can see anytime. So these are the few basic principles that manage the flow, and this, I think we discussed about it. Another thing is extreme programming. That is another method which is still popular, but not as popular as Scrum. So here the things are like, they say we will do, if something is good for us, we will do that only. That is called, that is why it is called extreme programming. And there are various methods or various, tools with this extreme programming uses, like whole team, the test-driven development, the pair programming, two people are doing one program at a time, refactoring, continuous integration, which is a basic principle of Agile also, right? Small releases, small iterations. So many things are like, are some like basic principle of Agile, which are there. And that's how it is called Agile practice as such. Sustainable pace, a constant pace as such, right? Following the collective ownership, do a collective, it is a failure of all or success of all, not one person or two person. So these are, with these principles, the extreme programming is also done over a period of time. It's not that popular, but still many teams are still using these frameworks. Another thing which has come is the lean software development. So lean, which was very popular in the manufacturing units, in manufacturing, like Toyota showed the way that how to use this. Now it has come into software and all principles, because they make the whole process very close to the actual person working and bring the agility. The Agile manifesto actually has accepted all lean principles, whatever are applicable in the software industry. So like eliminate the waste, that is the topmost thing in the in lean principle as such. Empower the team, deliver fast, right? Optimize, hold, build in quality. Quality should be built in, not be tested. Amplify learning, defer the decision. Don't take decision well in advance, very much in advance. Take a decision at the end. This may be very contrary to the common understanding. Now, I talked about like detail in Scrum and to show you what is Agile practices and what are the Agile methodology and how it works. And then talked about Kanban, introduce you with the Kanban, introduce with the extreme programming and lean. Now I will cover up some of the Agile practices which you should understand, because this applies across this and not very specific to like, okay, it's an overall thing, kind of thing. Just look at this question as such. Maybe you will get some idea. Look at this question, attempt this question. Yeah, I've launched the poll. You can attempt it. Last 10 seconds. Okay, so I stop this now and I will show you the result. So these are the results. So maximum votes have come to, I think, acceptance, test-driven development, and then behavior, and then the few to smoke testing and that. Like many things, if you are not very agile practitioners, you may find these terminologies are something like something from where they are coming kind of things. That's why I put it that these practices we should understand. So let's look at the answer as such. So the answer is behavior-driven development. And this is how behavior-driven developments talk about that. What is the user behavior we should understand and develop a test for this. And based on that, we do the coding actually. So it's a kind of a test-driven approach as such. Write test first, then write the code. So let's look into these various practices of Agile, which are like quite important, and they may not be PMP may not be expecting in-depth understanding of these things, but they expect that you should know that what is this and what they really mean, and should be able to apply them as such. So let's look at them. Something called impediment, obstacle, and blockers. You can consider them. The impediments are all our issues, basically. You can say all our issues. They slow down your progress. They create some kind of problems to you. They may maybe show a stopper also, and they maybe put you in trouble actually sometimes. So you can consider these things like impediments is a little issues, but not of that high intensity, maybe low severity issues. Obstacle is a kind of medium severity issues, and blocker is a kind of showstopper, a high severity issue actually. And it may stop your work and may not allow you to move ahead. Obstacle, maybe you have to put considerable effort to get rid of this. And impediment means with some efforts, you can actually manage it. The terminology is important. There's a lot of jargons and a lot of terminology being used in Agile, and which sometimes to many people look like a old wine in new bottle. But when Agile question being asked, these terminology become very important. Is servant leadership. The Agile promote servant leadership. What does it mean? Sometime back, I actually cover in this webinar a concept of type X manager and type Y manager. If some of you might have like attended that, you must be learning the type X manager and type Y manager. And I say how you can move from type X to type Y. So servant leadership is mainly a kind of type Y manager. Actually, you can say he's a leader kind of things. So he want to invest into people. He want people to grow. He help people as such, right? He help the stakeholders, educate them, right? Celebrate team success. Remove the impediments, remove the blockers, right? Create an environment everybody can contribute and succeed. Encourage people, give them training, give them coaching. Like basically invest and trust his people and allow them to do the work while standing behind as a protection. You can call it a kind of father figure as such. But do not interfere too much in that. That's a another servant leadership. Then there are some attributes of successful team. Successful team, like you can say, people are dedicated. They are not shared resource. Cross-functional team, we have discussed about that. All sort of people should be there. All skilled people should be there in the team. Co-location is an important thing. And in a virtual environment, it is a little challenging. But we have tools for that also. Mixed team of generalist and specialist, or T-shaped, I was talking about generalist and specialist, and a stable work environment. Like it's not changing too much, and it's giving a more comfort environment for the team to concentrate on the work and complete it. What are the other Agile practices, like creating a roadmap? Roadmap is something which talks about why we are doing this, how we achieve the objective. It provides a short-term and long-term visualization, a vision. Great guy. Story, a requirement written in the user's language. An epic is a collection of a story or is a big story, which can be divided into many stories. Right? A story point is a measurement of estimation, story estimation, how big the story is. Now, this story point is a relative term. So project A story point may not be same as project B story point, may not be same as project C story point. All story points are, so story point cannot be benchmarked to measure, to compare to project, because story points, one story point of project A may need 2 hours to complete, while the story point in project B may take whole day to complete. But the team decide what is the story point, or they work out actually in few iterations, they work out what is our story point. And this is how we will, so, or they can set, okay, our story point is this. We can, we will measure the, all the stories in terms of small stories. Since I found a small story, we can call it one story point. And if a story which is double of this, maybe two story point. If a story which is 10 times of this story is maybe a 10 story point. Maybe this is too big. You can divide them into two pieces, quite possible. So that is called story point estimations, and many methodology like planning poker, t-shirt sizing, feast to five are normally used. So what the picture image you are seeing is a planning poker where all the team members come together and they estimate and they show their cards on cards and show their cards. If they are matching, we select them. If they are not matching, then everybody explain to each other that why they have given that much story points. And then they again do this. And this process is repeated until a consensus is developed. So the Agile give a lot of emphasis on consensus. Then there is a concept of minimum viable product. What is a minimum viable product? A product, minimum features by which user can consider something functional. For example, if you look at the table, a very basic table, a simple table is given there, it can function, right? The people can sit, may not be very comfortable, but people can sit. So this can be considered as a minimum viable product. With the chair without, with three leg may not be a chair. It may not be stable, right? A chair without the back may not be called chair because it becomes a stool then. It's not a chair. So these are the minimum things which are required, and they are, so we can call this chair, the first thing is a minimum viable product, right? What is minimum business increment is the minimum functionality that can be added to minimum viable product to maintain its functionality. Means it is improved, it is now better, but it is functional. For example, from first image to second image, we have moved from here to here, something like that. And the difference between this and this is a minimum, minimum business increment, which by adding this, it has become this, right? May not be right exact example this, but in a product you can see, okay, if I add two more features, these specific two more features, the product will become more usable and working. So there's two more features are minimum business increment. Then there is a minimum marketable product. Now you can say that, okay, this table is good. This chair is good, the first one. This chair is good and it's okay, I can sit it, but basically we cannot market it. This, if we send it to the market, people will not buy it, right? This is not that kind. So marketable means you have to understand those features, collect those features which are minimum required to sell it, to give it to the consumer, actual user. That is minimum marketable product. And there is some called definition of done. Definition done is important because it helps keeping less number of WIP, work in progress item. So definition done means you write a criteria by which if the product meet, it is complete, or then item meet, it is complete. It can be put under done column. That is the definition. And it is very important that we should define definition of done. Velocity, as I'm saying, that we are delivering continuously on a constant pace. And that constant pace is nothing but the velocity. Initially, it may not be constant, but over a couple of iterations, it may be complete. It may be stable. It may get stable. Okay, we are delivering 4 story points in every iteration. We are delivering 10 story points in every iteration. And we keep delivering. Some little variations are okay, but it should be by and large that thing. Swarming is something which you get stuck on some feature and it's not getting completed. So what happens? All team come together, work on that feature and get it done. As a mission mode, we can say mission mode kind of things. Information radiator is a notice board. Simple notice board. You can say a notice board where all the things, all the status, all the details, everything can be put onto that board. And it board is put in the place where lot of where people are commonly going and coming around, right? Moving around in that place, a crowded area where the people often come. Like a pantry where you can put it. People often come over for a coffee and can see the information radiator, what is the state or everything related to the project, you can put it there. Then there are various prioritization techniques, prioritization of the product backlog. So there is a Kanno model, there is a Moscow model, there is a paired comparison analysis, 100 points. So you right-hand side, the model you are seeing is a Kanno model, actually. It helps us to prioritize the requirements, prioritize the product backlog. You can use any of those tools, whatever is suitable for you or whatever is feasible for you. Then there are practices which can be called test-driven development. So test-driven development, behavior-driven development, acceptance test-driven development, or red-green factor, all are test-driven development. All are test-driven development. The difference is there. In the test-driven development, we are not looking at the acceptance criteria. We are not looking at the user's behavior. But writing based on the person, when it comes to get the functionality, he write the test first and then write the functionality. In behavior, we look at the user, how, in what way user can use the things. And based on that, we write the test and then develop the product or then do the coding. In acceptance test-driven development, all team come together and look at the what is the acceptance criteria and what we need to code to meet that criteria. And just enough work we do that. So in these approaches, we write the test first, which can fail. Why it is failed? Because it is not developed. Then we work and write minimum code to make it success. Once it is success, we try to refactor and try to refine, optimize it. And that is this red green refactor concept come into picture. Many of these terminology you saw in many of the questions, and probably you are getting better idea. You probably like to change your answer, but it is gone a story now. I will give you more options actually now. There is a scrum of a scrum. There are a lot of things are happening. Big product is being developed. Many teams are there. Lot of teams are there. I saw there are 25 people working on a product. Now, if 25 people come together for 15 minutes for a daily stand-up meeting, what will happen? Chaos will happen. So we don't do that. We do a scrum of a scrum. There are 5 different groups. They have done their stand-up meeting, and then one representative from those 5 groups come together and do their stand-up meeting. And that is you also might have heard about scaled agile. So scrum of scrum is a kind of scaled agile. Similarly, there is a fishbowl windows in which actually I said that co-location is important. So it's a fishbowl kind of things. It's like you have a long running video conferencing. So you have done the video conferencing and the whole day it is running. People on the other side and this side, people can casually interact with each other. So it is like two people sitting under two different places and continuously working together and working like in one room through video conferencing, something like that. There is an spike. Spike is something probably many people might have not heard this, but spike is something that there is some R&D is required. Now R&D may take some time. R&D may can in issue. So we do an R&D in a time boxed manner. That is called a spike. Do R&D, but in a time span. It's time boxed manner. Do it in 2 weeks and come back and see what is happening. If further requiring it, go for another 2 weeks and do it. Or 1 week. 1 week, another do and do it. So it's a spike is something, is a kind of efforts we put up to make things certain, but in a time boxed manner. Right? So this is what the many things are. So now I have covered by and large all the things as such in what I wanted to cover, what I have put up these things for you. Let's do some more questions and let's see if we can, if we have better understanding. Probably not just by listening first time, you may be master, but let's try out whatever we have understood, have we, how much we have able to retain in this 1 hour actually. So question number six. So for, there are a few questions and we will do very quickly one by one. I think I will launch these things very quickly. So every question has 1 minute. So read it and answer it because that's what the time you will get in the PMP exam was. So the first question is here and you have 60 seconds. Okay, so this is over now and I will end the poll. So these are the answers. So answer is basically is A as such, and C is in fact opposite because the productivity is good. So they cannot be in a storming stage. The storming stage the reduce the productivity actually. So somewhat sometimes we don't understand the question properly. So that's okay. Let's go to the next one. And the next is here. Okay, 30 seconds left.
Hello, Vivek, sir.
Yes.
Yeah, can I request one here?
Yeah.
Before starting the poll, can you just give us some time for reading the question here?
Sure, because I will do that.
During the poll, I'm not able to read the question properly.
Oh, okay, okay. I will do that. Okay. I will do that.
Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. Okay, so this is the answer, and your answers I will okay, sorry, this is the answers, you can see that. So most of the like have gone into favor of C. I think that is the answer should also be right. Good. So okay, question number 8. I didn't know that you cannot read the questions when doing poll. You can read the question. Okay, now actually in the poll there's a limitation of words, so complete question doesn't come in the poll actually. Otherwise my preference was that I can put the whole question in the poll itself. Okay, 30 seconds left. Okay, 10 seconds. Fine. Okay, this is your answers. Quite like spread as such. And the answer is this actually. The answer is B, but I think majority of the people do attempt B as answer. Okay, and I go to the next one. Please read the question. Okay, I'm launching the. Ten seconds. Yeah, it's over. These are the answers. Mostly people have given the answer to the last, and that is right also. Great. So that's good. And let's go to the last question. This is the last question. Okay. Just read the question. I launch this. Okay. Okay, 15 seconds, 10 seconds. Okay, done. And this is the answer. I think there is a great contest between first and second. And let's see the answer. Answer is A, right? So, and maximum people do selected this. That's good. So, thank you very much. I think we are on time also. I'm sorry, I couldn't, like, I put a lot of questions for my side. I don't know how much time I leave. Probably we can take a couple of questions if it is okay with the people as such.
Yeah, I think one of the important questions, Vivek, is PMP certification versus PMI ACP certification. Because now Agile is part of the PMP.
Yeah.
So what do you see, what will happen in future?
Yeah, so Agile requires a much more in-depth understanding of ACP required, much more in-depth understanding of Agile. The PMP may not be that much. So PMP is by and large limited to something which I have normally covered here. And probably if you have good idea about this, this should be good enough. Only thing is you have to understand questions in a overall perspective. So ACP will remain there, but the PM, because it's by and large, a lot of acceptance is there of Agile. That's why it is included in the PMP. So may not be required that much of in-depth understanding of Agile as required in the ACP as such.
So let's say if I have a limited budget and limited time, can I just stick to PMP and avoid the ACP certification for the time being?
No, they are two different certifications. So ACP is just limited to Agile practices actually, while PMP is talk about a complete spectrum of project management. So it's talk about several things. Agile is a context in which those concepts are understood actually. Otherwise, ACP is a subset of PMP.
Okay. So I'm talking about from the job perspective point of view or potential point of view.
Yeah, when Agile is expected, then ACP is more important. But when a mature project manager is expected, then PMP. So PMP is for a mature project manager, practicing project managers. While the Agile is more a buddy project managers and the people who work on the ground more close to their team.
There's also a question, Vivek. After PMP, which certification is good for Agile? ASM or CSM?
This little difficult for me to answer or for anyone that is, I think the certificate which is more popular is more important because it is all about acceptance in the industry, is not about contents of the certification.
So one can go for after PMP certification, one can go for PMI ACP certification. Which will make more acceptability in the wide spectrum of industry.
Right. If you are in software industry, then yes. But maybe in non-software industry, the ACP may not be that much acceptable, or may not be that much valued.
Okay, nowadays, all industries are now, other than software also, they are now after Agile.
Yes.
What do you think?
The Agile, which is covered in PMP, is good enough.
It's good enough. Okay.
Yeah.
I think there are no more questions. So let me just thank you, Vivek,
yes,
for such a power-packed, knowledge-packed session. You have covered 30 hours of coursework in just 90 minutes, and you have touched most of the definitions and the keywords which anybody would be interested to know as far as Agile is concerned. So like always you do, a very, very comprehensive presentation in a short time. So thank you very much. And I must also thank all participants, because as I could see, even till the last question, more than 30, 34 people were engaged in answering the question, which itself is a good indicator that everyone was fully engaged in the learning process and also responding to your questions. So thank you very much, and
thank you
everyone for attending the session. Our next session will be likely on the finance for non-finance project professionals, and most probably Mr. Kalyan Raman would be taking up the session. So please register for the next session as well. It will be a very interesting session in the next month. Thank you very much.
Thank you to all of people for coming over here and listening to this. Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Vivek. Thank you, KG.
Thank you, Vivek ji.
Thank you, Vivek sir. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Vivek sir. Thank you all.